Greetings, it's New Zealand naturopath Eric Backer. I'm author of Candida Crusher and the formulator of the Candida range of dietary products. I've got an email question here from a man called Jeff Allen. Jeff Allen is from a small town called Paraumu here in New Zealand, in the southern part of the North Island. And Jeff's asking me if diabetes, actually his question is here, is Candida and diabetes connected? Can one cause the other? Good question, Jeff. Let's talk a bit about the Candida and the diabetes connection. So there are different kinds of diabetes. In fact, there are three types of diabetes, but two more commonly recognized, type 1, or autoimmune diabetes, and type 2, what we call mature age onset. Type 3 diabetes is a newer form now, or also called metabolic syndrome, and it comes about through obesity, high blood pressure, dyslipidemia, so you've got elevated blood lipids. And so this type 3, not many people have heard about that one. So diabetes is a very common phenomenon, Jeff. It's very, very growing epidemic in the Western world. And it comes through Western living. It comes through basically eating the wrong kind of food, not exercising and getting obese. And major blood sugar dysregulation occurs. So blood sugar regulation occurs primarily through a gland called the pancreas, which secretes a hormone called insulin. Only a very small percentage of the pancreas is involved in the production and release of insulin through the Acini cells. The bulk of the pancreas makes up enzymes and bicarbonate to help, you know, assist digestion. Insulin is very important because it's a hormone that allows the body to push glucose inside the cell. It binds to receptor sites and activates cells. So glucose powers up the body. Another hormone called cortisol is produced by the adrenal gland, and cortisol helps the body to assist in the long-term regulation of blood sugar between meals. When the blood sugar level, you know, in the blood drops, the brain will sense that and it will actually liberate stored glucose called glycogen by way of cortisol. I hope you're still with me and understand this, so you may want to watch the video again. So insulin is required to get the blood sugar into the cell through the receptor sites on the cell. Cortisol is released when blood sugar level drops a little bit too much, because cortisol will allow the body to break down stored sugar, generally in the liver and some other parts of the body, to be released in the bloodstream, which will be then converted to glucose. So if you've got diabetes, it's much easier for you to get urinary tract infections, of course, because you're going to have a more blood sugar output, you know, a urine output of sugar. And mellitus means sweet urine, diabetes mellitus. So, that could be another thing that diabetics get, is increased incidence of urinary tract infection, vaginal infection, and also skin yeast infections. Many kinds of yeast infections are prevalent with diabetics because of their dysregulation of glucose. And of course, Candida loves glucose, so it will feed on that. But type 1 diabetes is entirely different. It's generally juvenile and you're born with it. Autoimmune disease it is, meaning that the body is actually attacking the pancreas and destroying it, causing a permanent lifelong dysregulation of glucose, usually requiring the injection of insulin. So here in New Zealand, we have ads on TV now for slow-release insulin that you can actually inject. So, and type 3 diabetes or metabolic syndrome is really, I call it metabolic syndrome, S-I-N-drome, because sinners get it. You know, dietary sinners get it, exercise sinners get it. These are people that sit on the couch with remote controls and often don't want to do too much. So they end up really large people, and they get not just the diabetic, you know, type 2 type problems, but they get a lot of hypertension and many other associated problems that go with obesity. So what happens with the Candida? Candida creates actually a real problem in the body, because it can actually make this enzyme called secreted aspartyl protease, or SAPs. The University of California, San Diego, worked this out a while ago, that this secreted enzyme that Candida actually produces has a really bad effect on the body by destroying the receptor sites on cells and not allowing glucose to really go into the cell, you know, to power it up. So this creates an increase in glucose in the body. So Candida, in fact, can cause type 2 diabetes. It's not really well known by medical practitioners, and they tend to laugh at this whole thing, but research has shown now that it actually does occur. So people with severe candida, in many cases, can actually develop diabetes. So this this protease, this enzyme, is also linked with hypertension. It's linked with immune dysregulation. It's linked with big yeast infection. So there certainly is a link there, Jeff, between these two sorts of things. The other big thing you've got to remember is diabetes can come about also when you've got severe adrenal problems on top of candida. So candida and adrenal fatigue often go hand in hand. These are two conditions I commonly see, particularly people non-responsive to treatment with candida, who will get partially well then relapse. They can often have an adrenal fatigue problem because they've got a problem with their cortisol. So cortisol is one of the most powerful hormones to regulate your immune function. So if cortisol's not working properly, you're going to have a really big problem. And if you've got this secreted protease enzyme floating in your body from candida, stuffing up or ruining the receptors on cells, and you've got low cortisol, you're going to have a major problem on your hand. So these are a couple of mechanisms by why some candida patients don't seem to recover, how they'll get partially better and then relapse, partially better and then relapse. And many inexperienced practitioners that treat candida patients don't really understand the concept of the secreted aspartyl proteases. They don't have also look at the byproducts of candida metabolism, like mannan, and the gliotoxins produced by candida, particularly poisons that neutralize the immune function. So the immune system is very important when it comes to protecting the body from the effects of diabetes. It downregulates inflammation, stops infections. It's very powerful also to help control autoimmune responses to stop type 1 diabetes getting worse, for example. So there are multiple connections by which candida and diabetes exist. So the main thing I'd like you to understand is it's important to get a yeast infection under control, because it's not only linked with candida, it's linked with many other different kinds of chronic degenerative diseases that we know. So that's a bit of a long, convoluted answer to your question, Jeff, but I hope you do get some appreciation for this. Don't forget to do my yeast infection quiz to see what your score is. You can do that on yeastinfection.org. And please subscribe to this channel for more videos like this. And don't forget my Canzeta range of dietary supplements. You'll find that at canzeta.com. Thanks for tuning in.